Welcome to Brazil Church of the Nazarene. We're here to seek Him, celebrate Him, serve Him, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So I hope you can buckle in your seatbelts and put up your flight trays and get ready for liftoff. We're on a journey. Psalm 24, we read it last week. He asked, who may ascend into the hill of the Lord, or who may stand in his holy place, he who has clean hands, and he goes on. Then he ends the psalm, lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, Yahweh mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. Lord, we just start the service by saying, we want you to be here. So our praise, our glory, our whatever is good in us, we lift up to you today. Because you are worthy. You are worthy. Help us, Lord, to focus on you. May our worship be pleasing to you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand.
There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in all of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 the sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Coming back to welcome me far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown. I shall reign with him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every singing as I go.
Next song.
I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. There never was a sweeter melody. 'Tis the melody of love. In my heart there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody of love. I love the Christ who died on Calvary, for he washed my sins away. He put within my heart a melody, and I know it's there to stay. In my heart there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody of love. 'Twill be my endless theme in glory. With the angels I will sing. 'Twill be a song with glorious harmony. When the courts of heaven ring, in my heart there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody of love.
and higher than the mountains that I face, and stronger than the power of the grave, and constant in the trial and the change, this one thing remains, this one thing. Your love never fails and never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your it never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up. It never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up. It never runs out on me. Your love. And on and on and on and on it goes. It never runs out on me. Your love. Your love.
Amen. All right, you may all be seated. We're going to do a special here. A couple weeks ago, Elis and I sang this song at her grandmother's 75th birthday, and it's one that we enjoyed, thought it'd be fun to do here for you guys. But before we start, I do have to say, hey teens, I want you to look back. Glenna, could you stand and wave? Could you stand and wave? Stand and wave. That's Glenna, guys. All right, thank you. The teens didn't know who you were. And I'm like, you guys should know who Glenna is. Come on. right. Yeah.
Oh, the desert dreams of a river that will run down to the sea. Like my heart longs for an ocean to wash down over me. Oh, won't you take me from this valley to that mountain high above? Oh, I will pray, pray, pray till I see your smiling face. I will pray,
pray, pray
to the one I love.
And oh, the outcast dreams of acceptance just to find pure love's embrace. Like an orphan longs for its mother, may you hold me in your grace.
Oh, won't you take me from this valley to that mountain high above? Oh, I will pray,
pray, pray
till I see your smiling face. I will pray,
pray, pray
to the one I.
Ooh, 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 ooh,
ooh, ooh, the caged bird dreams of a strong wind that will flow beneath her wings like a voice longs for a melody. Oh, Jesus, carry me.
Take me
from this valley to that mountain high above. Oh, I will
pray, pray, pray till I see your smiling face.
I will pray,
pray, pray
to the one I love. Oh, I will pray,
pray, pray till I see your smiling face.
We'll pray,
pray, pray to the one I love. Yeah, I sing tenor.
They got a little country in them. All righty. We're switching gears and going back to the Old Testament to a book called Nehemiah. And we'll stay here until next week. Or we may stay here till next year. Nehemiah, last of the historic books in the Old Testament. Maybe you don't know this, but the Old Testament is not according to chronology. It is a little bit, but it's according to genre of Scripture. New Testament is similar in that we have the Pentateuch in the Old Testament, then we have the historic books. And then you have the poetry. And then you have the major prophets and minor prophets. And so it is according to that that we have it separated, just like you have the Gospels and then the historical book, the Acts, and then you have letters. and then you end up with Revelation. So it you know, gotta take that in perspective, because some people, if you ever get a chronological Bible, it's very interesting because it will jump all over the place. You'll hear a little bit of that in the sermon this morning, and hopefully begin to tie it all in together, because it's important to note why things were written when they were written as well. So let's stand as we look at Nehemiah, the first four verses. Words of Nehemiah, the son of Hachaliah, came to pass in the months of Chislev, in the 20th year of the king's reign, as I was in Shushan, the citadel, the palace, that Hanani, one of my brethren, came with men from Judah, and I, which is Nehemiah, asked them concerning the Jews who had escaped, who had survived the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said to me, the survivors who are left from the captivity in the province are there in great distress and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem is also broken down, and its gates are burned with fire. So it was, when I heard these words, that I sat down and wept and mourned for many days. I was fasting and praying before the God of heaven. Lord, bless your word again. Thank you for Nehemiah. And thank you for your working in the Old Testament. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Now, I think of the book of Nehemiah is interesting because it is the last Old Testament history. There was, following Nehemiah, a period of 400 silent years. The events of Nehemiah here at the beginning are about 445 B.C. So it's the last Old Testament history, 400 silent years, and then the next thing we have biblically is the Gospels, the arrival of Jesus. Now, Nehemiah records the last known events occurring in Jerusalem, where Nehemiah is going to go, if you read in the book. The last events, historically, before the birth of Christ, and the birth of John the Baptist, and the New Testament. So it's kind of important and interesting. Nehemiah took on a great responsibility of restoring this important capital city. He helped it to become ready for the arrival of the Messiah. Think about that. Who may ascend to the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? He that has clean hands and pure heart. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. That's Psalms. Nehemiah would have been real familiar with that. He's helping prepare the way for the arrival of the King of glory. So let's get some quick background. God's people taken captive by the Babylonians because they kept disobeying God, as was forewarned. Isaiah, Jeremiah, so on. Ezekiel. And so they were taken captive. They were forced into exile by the Babylonians, including the famous one called Daniel. And the three Hebrew boys, we think of the fiery furnace. Daniel was one of those who was taken, ripped out of his home country into exile. And when this happened, Jerusalem was literally torn apart, destroyed, walls leveled, gates burned, Solomon's temple, a wonderful, awesome temple, destroyed. Anything that was of value melted down, you know, the gold, all that was put into that temple was removed, including even the temple utensils made out of gold. Gold fixtures, anything of value carried off. And remember in the book of Daniel, when he gets called out because there's handwriting on the wall. Literally, that's where that phrase comes from. To interpret what was being written, as they were partying and drinking from the temple goblets, equipment that was dedicated to God, they were using for their idol worship. And that's when the hand of God appeared in their drunken stupor. With the words that Daniel interpreted. You are weighed in the balance and found wanting. This night your kingdom will be taken from you and delivered to the Medes and the Persians. And that was the night when they stopped the water going under the wall of Babylon and marched their armies through that dried up waterbed and took over. And the Babylonian Empire fell, and the Medes and the Persians became the next dominant force. Followed later by Alexander the Great and the Greeks, followed later by the Roman Empire and Caesar, who was in control when Jesus came. So now the Medes and the Persians, and Daniel is under them and becomes an advisor. And you remember the stories. So under the new leadership of the Medes and Persians, who are more favorable toward the Israelite people, and you'll know why, Cyrus, you hear about this and so on, 50,000 of the Jewish exiles were allowed to return to Jerusalem under the leadership of Zerubbabel. That's where you find it, the story in the beginning of Ezra. And these first returnees began to build the homes they lived in. And they laid a foundation for the new temple. But they got discouraged and quit. They had a lot of opposition. The people in the land did not want Israel reinstated. They did not want Jerusalem to become what it used to be. They did not want the worship of Yahweh. And so they fought against him. They got discouraged and quit. 16 years went by. And then if you read in the Minor Prophets, the last three have to do with Nehemiah. Haggai and Zechariah were written sermons, admonitions, challenging the people to get back to work and rebuild the temple of God. You say, why? You know, we read through them and go, what's the big deal? It was a big deal. They were reestablishing Jerusalem, but they weren't reestablishing the religion, the worship of their God, unique in the world, invisible, no idols. So they challenged them to return to the work. And the temple was completed in 4 years, 20 years after the first group returned, 50,000. Next, historically, I have to pull away a little bit from Ezra to go to Esther. Esther was a Jewish girl who became queen after Vashti, the queen, was deposed because she failed to appear to the king in a drunken stupor to entertain the men. So he kicked her out and went searching for a new one, and Esther was picked. And Esther was a Jew. And she began to influence, because if you read the story, there was a plot out again to destroy the Jewish people all across the land of Persians. And she took her life in her own hands to go before the king and plead for her people, which I don't even know if he knew it was her people. I don't know. Mordecai, her uncle, said, "This is the time. You've been put here for such a time as this." She put her life on the line and saved the Jewish people across the land who were about to be exterminated. Now we jump back away from Esther to Ezra, and 60 years after the temple was rebuilt, Ezra, a priest, was allowed to return with another group from the empire. And he arrived in Jerusalem, and the book of Ezra ends with Ezra beginning a process of trying to restore spiritual life among the people in Jerusalem. And 10 years later, we have the events recorded in the book of Nehemiah, who's going to bring the third group of exiles back. But you don't know that yet, reading the first four verses. Now, Nehemiah would superintend also the rebuilding of the walls around that important city. Up until then, Nehemiah was living a routine life. Nehemiah's life was just routine. Now, you've got to picture this and put this in your mind. Nehemiah was a man accustomed to life in exile. Over 150 years had passed since the Babylonian exile began, some think up to 160 years. So you think of that period of time, generations of Jewish people, Daniel and all on, were ones that were yanked out. We think about their story, but there were many others now that had been in exile their entire life. And now we're into third, fourth, fifth, maybe more generations. So Nehemiah, like Esther, had never lived in the homeland. First under the Babylonians and then under the Persians, these people grew up in exile. There are some stories about how they hung their harps in the willows. Some of the older ones that had actually remembered the homeland and their tears. They could not sing the songs of Zion anymore. Well, Nehemiah grew up. If he heard any of them, it's because his parents or grandparents or somebody taught him about homeland, about Israel people, about their invisible God, about their faith. And about Jerusalem. And I want to note that this shows the importance of sharing about God to your children, to our Sunday school class, to the people around you, in children's church, we worship, whatever. Because why? Because if we don't share it, we have a generation who's growing up who knows nothing. We are living in exile today from a Christian nation. It's the post-Christian era where the majority of Americans no longer believe in Jesus. So you better share. Because we're only one generation away from extinction as a. And the concern is, of course, that most of our churches are filled with elderly people. And when they are gone, if you are here under the age of 30, think about what your world's going to be like in 20 more years when all the elderly people holding all these little churches open are gone. I'm not saying that as a downer. I'm saying that as a challenge. Because this has happened in many nations, many times, over the years, and it has always been a remnant of God's people who have said, we will share, we will live, we will serve. We seek Him, celebrate Him, and serve Him. And that remnant has created the ongoing Christianity. And while it seems to be moving from America, it is taking over in many of the countries in Africa. It is taking over in South America. It is taking over, becoming the dominant religion in other places around the world where people are hungry for the truth. And America, in its affluency and in its higher education and its better way of living, is losing. What we once had. We've enjoyed it for a couple hundred years. But revival is always around the corner. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sins, and I will heal their land. That's not even in the sermon notes. None of that was. Back to Nehemiah. According to the last sentence in chapter 1, Nehemiah was appointed to the job of the king's cupbearer. I don't know if you would want to volunteer for this job, but I believe it was very lucrative. This task of a cupbearer, and they've had him before, because remember when Joseph was in prison and he had the dream about the baker and the butler, the cupbearer, in his day. All right, so this was going on, and the job was very important, because what you were to do as a cupbearer is every time a drink came to the king, and they had plots to remove kings. It's been going on. His job was to drink it first and then go. In case it was poisoned, he probably had a lot of fun with it. I would if I was the guy. Some of you would too. It's your personality. Collapse two or three times a day. gotta make your money, your job worthwhile, right? And put a little drama into it. And if he didn't die within 5-10 minutes or whatever the case may be, then the king got to sip his saliva. Because he'd already been in the cup. So that was a pretty important job. And Nehemiah then became a person, because of the position, to have the king's trust. Because he could fake the sip, or fake, if he knew, the king could die if Nehemiah was not trustworthy. And over time, it is believed that he may have, because he's there all the time, because that drink is, or the king's always thirsty, is that he was there and he got to hear all the stuff and he got to be involved in a lot of things and probably became one of the king's trusted advisors. Remember, God's working. God's working. Queen Esther is married to Ahasuerus, the Hebrew word mentioned in Esther, but we know him as Xerxes, who is the father of Artaxerxes. And Artaxerxes is now the king whom Nehemiah is the cupbearer for. Maybe Esther used her influence as a Jewish girl to get Nehemiah, a Jewish guy, a job next to the king, because God is working and knew that Nehemiah had a job to do for the kingdom of God. Coincidence or God? Such a strategic spot for him to be in. So the book of Nehemiah opens by telling us it's the 20th year of Artaxerxes' reign, and they had moved from the northern palace up in the mountains to the plains close to the Persian Gulf, 150 miles or so north, to the citadel there where the king would stay during the winter months down on the plains until the summer heat began to roll in as the change of the season, and they would head back up the hills into the mountains where it was cooler. Nice to be a king with two places to live, like those snowbirds that live up north and then in the wintertime they head to the south and then come back. So that's what he would do, and so that's why they're there. Nehemiah's job is important enough that he would travel with the king from one palace to the other. Now, Nehemiah was living his routine life. This is what we know. He's a cupbearer. He's in the palace, the southern palace. He's doing his job, a great job, easy to do, lots of benefits and perks. Cushy. Chance to die, but hey, you got the best food, best clothes, a spot in front of the kingdom. You knew everything that was going on. He had it made. His routine was great. But God had other plans. God needed Nehemiah to do an important ministry for him. So Nehemiah received news of a problem. Second point. So Nehemiah's routine life is upset when a group of men, a delegation of some sort, came to the palace with news about Jerusalem, this special city of God that Nehemiah had heard about many times. And Jerusalem was the place where Jehovah was worshipped back 200 years ago. Jerusalem was the place where King David, the greatest ancestor that they knew of, who was a man after God's own heart, and killed Goliath and conquered the lands around him and made Israel the country that it was. He lived in Jerusalem. It was the center of worship for the breadbasket of the world. In the Fertile Crescent. And Solomon followed with such pomp and with such splendor, with such glory, that people would come from other countries to visit him and bring gifts. This is the place. One of the most powerful kingdoms of their day. He'd heard about it. Jerusalem was the center of so much Jewish history. And so Nehemiah was curious and began to ask this delegation questions about this ancestral home that he heard about. But what he received back in answers was not good. The people there, already 50,000 had gone back, plus those that had been left behind when all the good people, Daniel and so on, the young, strong men, were taken off into captivity. Those that were left, they had their children and their children and their children. But they're living off of the land. And 50,000 came back. And then another group, a couple thousand under Ezra. And so they're trying to restore this city. How's it going? Well, they're getting all kinds of conflict. They're devastated. They're in distress. They're under reproach. When Ezra's there and they're trying to do something good, they write letters to whoever's in the king and the country that's over them and say, they're going to have a revolution over here. These Jewish people are trying to rise up. They're going to fight against you. They have a history of doing that. And they'd send a letter to cease and desist. Politics was hard at work, even in that day, against God's people. And then they said, the wall of Jerusalem is broken down and its gates burned with fire. Verse 3. So 150, 160 years earlier, Babylonians have been efficient of their devastation of this city. Some had been allowed to return from exile, but they were demoralized. And their city had no wall. So what's the significance of having a wall around Jerusalem? I could turn this into a political rally right now. Build the wall. Build the wall. But then John would get up and leave. And a few others. And that's not what this is about. I'm picking on John. He knows why. I never pick on people. Why did it bother Nehemiah so much when he heard this news? There's no wall. There's no gates. Because Nehemiah, even in exile, had always lived in cities surrounded by a wall with gates that closed and barred. His entire life, that was the society of the world in that day. Every city of any significance had walls and gates. They had a way to control access and exits. Nehemiah knew that walls were essential. Why? What's the big deal about Jerusalem having a wall? Number one, protection. Many people lived in that day with a forager mindset. Anybody outside of a city wall felt like anything out there is up for grabs. If you weren't out there with your sheep could be taken. If you were traveling between point A and point B, you got in a caravan with a whole lot of guys with a lot of armor and a lot of armament, way to fight, because you would be attacked. It was still happening in Jesus' day. The story of the Good Samaritan. They lived with that forager mindset. If you're out here in the open, you're fair game. So those within a wall could unite, protect their families, protect their animals, protect their goods, protect their food. Protect the things that were necessary for a city to thrive and to survive. The functioning life of a city depended upon the fact that they could be protected from those outside. A group of robbers, an enemy tribe, because a lot of times they would band together and come against. What is it they always did in those days? They had to find a way to get over the walls or through the walls or break down the walls in order to take a city. Why do we have Jericho? God working a miracle so the walls could fall down because there was no way the Israelite people could ever take that city. Protection's important. We need to be protected. We need a safe place away from spiritual warfare. Second is separation. The wall was necessary for separation because those inside the city are separated from the evil outside of their community. Again, we're talking about Jewish people who believed in a God that's different than the idol-worshipping Canaanites around them, some who did animal sacrifice, some who did human sacrifices, some who did all kinds of prostitution and all kinds of things in their worship that had nothing to do with the way Yahweh was to be worshipped. And they were constantly, in the whole Old Testament history, which is the reason why the exile happened, they were constantly being infiltrated by this filth that they were to stay separated from. The Old Testament kings following Solomon began this. Soon there were more temples to other gods in Jerusalem than there was Yahweh. One temple for Yahweh. People like Jezebel brought her idol worships, her priest. Why did Elijah have a contest? You know the stories. Separation. Because the Jewish people constantly warned, stay away from the sinful influences and idols of the people around them. A wall, a means of separation, was important to them. Then the third reason is identity. The missing walls were the first thing that people would see as they approached the city of Jerusalem. What would they notice? Well, there's 50, 60, 70,000 inhabitants in this city. But they don't have a wall. The lack of a wall sent out a visible message that this city had issues. It had problems, unlike any other important city in their day. Of course, they built them on hills, too, to help with the defense and being able to see, because you could look down. So you had to go up to Jerusalem, regardless of what direction you came from. But without a wall, people would see from miles away, something's wrong. That city has no real means of protection and separation. And so I call it identity issue because for the Jewish people, this became a reflection on their God. Jehovah obviously was no good as a God. He allowed them to be defeated, to be carried off into exile. Jehovah was no good. Their wall was destroyed, and anybody that came and saw the city that was trying to be rebuilt for the one true God, they would look at it and say, their God's nothing. They don't even have a wall. If you follow their God, you're a loser. You're seeing now why Nehemiah's got this on his heart. But there's a fourth reason we need a wall. Spiritual restoration. This is perhaps the most important of all. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Be lifted up, you everlasting doors. The King of Glory is coming. The destruction of the Jewish temple, the destruction of Jerusalem as a capital city, symbolized the curse of Yahweh, Jehovah, for the people of God breaking the covenant relationship with God. It was a sign all across all the nations of the world as their city fell one after another to Nebuchadnezzar and his armies. Of course, he was doing that around the world, taking other countries as well. So Jerusalem walls must be rebuilt as a visible sign that the covenant is being restored, that God's forgiveness and his blessing and his presence would come back to his people there in Jerusalem. If there was to be a spiritual restoration of the God that they had shunned, and there must be a rebuilding of not just the city and the temple, but of the wall of separation, of protection and identity and spiritual restoration. That he is the God who restores. Jerusalem's health symbolized the level of spiritual health of God's people, who most of them are still in exile. And that symbol of spiritual health was very low. They didn't even have a wall. Ninety years had passed since Zerubbabel brought the first group of 50,000. 90 years. There's no wall of protection, no separation, no identity, no spiritual restoration around this important city, ancestral home, and center of the Jewish religion for thousands of years. And Jesus is coming in 400 and some years. And Nehemiah didn't know it, but if there's going to be a city and a nation that Jesus could come to, he had an important task. So this was devastating news to Nehemiah. Never been there. He only knew what he had been told. I don't know if they had scrolls. I don't know. I don't know how much he knew. But he had a relationship with God. So in the middle of his routine life with a cushy job, living out this comfortable, I've got it made, enviable position of any Jewish person, besides maybe Queen Esther. Wow. But now Nehemiah realized that the life of his people was in terrible condition. And through this news, God gave him a vision of an important need. Point number three, Nehemiah was hit with a burden. So it was, verse 4, when I heard these words, my knees just went out from under me. I sat down and wept and mourned for many days. I was fasting and praying before the God of heaven. These are the written words of a person no longer enjoying his routine, his cushy life, his easy job. How could he live a life of ease and affluence when God's people, his countrymen, were suffering? And the only thing he knew from the history of his people was to take that need, that burden, that crushing load to God in prayer. And we can look at from this chapter to the next chapter when he gives another date that he spent 100 days, 3 months, praying every day, fasting when he could, mourning, weeping, 100 days. Something needed to be done. Yahweh needed to intervene. And Nehemiah didn't know what to do, but he knew he could pray. If this God they told him about was real, then he could pray. If this God really cared about his people, then he should pray. And a sample of his daily prayer is recorded the rest of chapter 1. I believe he prayed something similar to that every day. And my friends, this is how real ministry begins. You will never be motivated to do anything until you first recognize a need. Nehemiah could visualize the people of Jerusalem living unprotected, surrounded by a wall of ruins. No wall at all. Hundreds of miles away, he felt the burden. He carried the concern, and he began to pour out his heart to God. My people, my country, my capital city is not doing good. And this is how true ministry begins. Sadly, some people don't respond the way Nehemiah did. Many God's people today get so used to the routine, the sin, the corruption. They see the need every day. They hear it on the news. But it just, as long as I got money and I can buy my groceries, and the gas doesn't go too high, and I got my family to go visit, and I can show up on church on Sunday morning, I guess I'm okay. Do you think our capital city could use some prayer? Think our leadership could use some fasting? I don't know that the November election will solve anything because we keep sending the same kind of people to do the leadership across our nation. Interesting enough, as I watch a little bit of the Republican National Convention and then the Democrat National Convention, and I thought how much like a church it was. They did a little music off on the side. They had a pulpit set up there. Preachers came out and preached to the crowd, and they all went, yay, yay, yay. And then the next preacher would come out, and then the next preacher, and they sat there for literally hours being preached to about their God. And their beliefs. And not one life was changed. Think of it! America is watching itself collapse. And the church is collapsing with it. Little uprisings here and there of people concerned about God. We will not probably resurrect our nation. It falls off the pages of history in the Bible. But we still have a responsibility to the next generation. We still have a responsibility to weep, to mourn, to fast, and to pray. But it starts with recognizing a need. If you are so comfortable in a heathen nation that you don't see a need, this is your altar. This is your place to begin. Pains me to tell this story. While I was in seminary, I took my first church, technically my first church. I did another one while I was in Bible college for a little while, but 2-hour commute from seminary, moved into the parsonage, Nazarene Church, in the town in the next state over. It was a difficult life. I had kids. I had a wife who's raising the kids. Never had enough money. That's not the problem. Young pastor giving it at all. Working on the side, working for the church, traveling back and forth to seminary. And God gave us a new family out of the rough. Dad was drinking beers when I go and visit him. They had no clue. But here were these precious kids. The problem was, Debbie's teaching the little children's class. Another board member's teaching the youth class. Another board member's teaching the adult class. But we had no class for these new kids. Like a good pastor, I showed up in board meeting, burdened, concerned. Here's the need. Here's these 3 or 4 kids that are starting to come because they were bringing their friends. Would anybody like to teach this class? I've already put in my time. No, I've did all that before. Excuse after excuse after excuse. Because they didn't recognize the need. That's where it starts, my friends. They were just children from off the streets. Somebody will tell them about God. That church closed within a year or two. If you don't see a need, if you don't see the lost, if you don't see the ministry, then God's not going to work through you. I've said this so many times. Why are you here? Why hasn't God taken you? You haven't died yet because God still has something for you to do. Where is your ministry? Why does God have you here? My friends, real ministry begins when you catch a vision of a need so strong it drives you to your knees. Do you see the ruins? Do you notice what sin has done to your family? To your town? To your nation? Does that particular need burden you to get to verse 4? To weep, to mourn, to fast, and to pray. Are you ready to go all in? Oh, Pastor, you just keep pushing that. I wonder why. Why does God keep laying this on us? We're one of the bigger churches in town, and we're a small church. If this town has any future, it's going to be because people get concerned. If your family has a future, it's because somebody's getting concerned. If our country can last without going totally bonkers, It'll be the prayers of Christians that hold it back from going over the precipice. Are you mourned over a sin in your own life that you refuse to give up and God keeps saying, let it go, get rid of it, and you're still holding on? You'll never be anything for Christ until you die out to that sin. Are you burdened for a friend who's controlled by evil and you see it taking him down, her down, destroying them, their life, their family, their home? Does it bother you at all? Are you indifferent? As you read the Bible, the Gospels, the compassion of Jesus, as Jesus says, oh, look at this one and look at that one. My favorite, most heart-wrenching scene in the Chosen movie is when Jesus has spent the day touching lives, and the disciples are back around the fire, fussing and fighting and carrying on, and Jesus comes in, too exhausted to eat, and flops in the tent because he carries the load. And they just worried about their little shift out there working on the line. Do you weep over the Christians whose lives don't reflect Jesus? Whose social media presence is anti-Jesus and his love and compassion? My friends, is God calling you to get involved, to make a difference, to have a real love for God and a love for others that we talk about all the time? Love God, love your neighbor. Jesus said, summarizes the whole book. And yet we love ourselves to the point where we just want our cushy, comfortable, routine life. Don't disturb me, God. I've already put in my time. And we have people here who are literally overworked, while the spectator mentality has invaded the church. When I was in seminary, the statistic was 20% do 80% of the work. It may be worse than that now. If you have Jesus in your heart, you have an obligation to seek him and celebrate him. But you also have an obligation to serve. And if you think I'm coming down on any of you, I am not. Because I don't know how much you pray. I don't know how much you give. I don't know how much you do in this community. I don't know if you witness to people at your work. I don't know what your ministry is. I do some of the people that work around here. But many of you, I have no clue. But you're here for a reason, my friends. And before you hit that exit door, on your conveyor belt of life, that takes us back to last week, so if you weren't here, you missed it. You better know that you've done your best for God. Now let's talk about guilt. Guilt can cause a sinner to turn to Christ. That's a good thing. Conviction, guilt, whatever. But guilt is not a good motivation for real ministry. If this sermon makes you feel a little guilty, then we've missed it. There should be something inside that loves God so much that you would gladly do something for him. Guilt's not the motivation, it's love. Love is the motivation. God so loved that he gave. How much do you love God that you will give? You need to recognize a need. A burden from God is the only true motivation that will work. You need to love God until he gives you something to do. And do it because you love God. Nehemiah is on the conveyor belt of his life, tracking and trucking, doing his routine, going from point A to point Z in his life. Then news came of an important issue that gripped his heart and his mind, and the problem that he saw became a burden, which he took before the Lord in prayer and fasting. What problems do you see in your life? What problem do you see in your sphere of influence, the people you hang with? How can you change? What does God want to change in me and you? What difference does God want you and I to make before we hit that exit? So our prayer this morning should be, oh God, give us eyes to see what you see, and a heart to feel what hurts you. Eyes to see, a heart to feel what you are calling me and this church to do. And we can pawn it off on the church. The church needs to do this. Church, who's the church? It's the individuals. The church will never do anything. It's the individuals. That can do the work of God. And so you see me, you see the praise team, you see the people up front. Oh, we're working hard. We're doing our ministry. But there's more. There's more. There's more. What does God want me to do? One of the things that's been bothering me the most is, what else can I do? I love this. This is what God called me to do. But there's more. There's more. So begins Nehemiah. Praise team can come. Lord, I've just bowed my head, my heart. Give me a vision. Give me a burden. Too many churches are closing. There's not enough pastors. There's not enough people paying the tithe to keep a church door open. There's not enough of the next generation committing themselves to God and the church. We're struggling all over. So we point back and pull into our shell and say, okay, but what if, God, you're trying to say, it's time? What if, God, you're trying to say, there's more? What if, Lord, you know that each of us have a neighbor, a friend, a family member? What if, and it's the big if, before I hit the exit door of life, one more person can come to know Jesus Christ? My goal as I get older is to think about how can this church continue for another generation? And the answer keeps coming back. The only way is if the current generation gets busy. So, Lord, I've delivered what you laid in my heart. But now we all got to get busy. And it's going to start right here around this altar of prayer. Lay it on our heart to see the need. Give us something to fast and pray about. Give us something to weep over. Give us a burden that makes us mourn. That older generation is dying. Who's going to carry the burden in prayer? Who's going to teach the classes? Who's going to reach the lost? Jesus, bring us to our knees. Let's stand together.
Close to you, never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. Will do, 'cause nothing else could take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace and help me find the way and bring me back to you. to you.
Maybe all of you can help me this morning in a prayer time. Just taking your hands and putting them out in front of you. And put the palms down. And help us, Lord, now to release the things that we cling to so tightly. Help us to drop them. Our judging attitudes, our excuses, our sins, our hurts, our grudges, our issues, our problems, our excuses. It's time to let them go. It's time to release them. Drop our stones where we want to throw them at the woman who's been caught in an adultery. To drop, Lord, our sharp tongues, our words, our attitudes. Oh, that party in control and that person over there and that issue in Washington, D.C. We blame everybody else. When you realize that we're the Nehemiah and you're calling us, Lord, to be the one to make a difference. So, Lord, we drop those excuses, those problems, those issues, those sins right here. In the sanctuary before Almighty God. And those watching online in their bedrooms, in their kitchen, wherever they are, Lord, in their prayer room, just let it go. I don't like my life. I don't like what's going on. I don't like what's happening in my country. I don't know what's happening in my family, but Lord, I just have to give it to you. And now, congregation, if you'll help me by turning your hands the other way. Because, Lord, now we want to say, fill us. When we get rid of our junk, Lord, then you can come in and fill us. Fill us up. Here's my cup, Lord. I'm not much, but fill it up. Fill me full of you. Fill me with energy. Fill me, Lord, with strength. Fill me with the vision. Fill me with the burden. Fill me, Lord, with a desire to make a difference. Give me more of you. Give me your strength. Give me the desire to get more than my toes wet. Help me, Lord, this week to get up to my knees. And then get up to the waist next week. Until I walk deeper and deeper into this relationship with God. Until it's over my head. Until all I feel and all I see and all I know is there's a God in heaven who wants to do something in my life. Because these children are worth it. Because my family is worth it. Because, Lord, you are worth it. Because, Lord, I love you. As much as we love the family members who are lost, I've got to love you more. As much as I hate to see my country, who I love, but I have to love you more. So fill me up with more of you. Fill me, Lord. Fill my family, my church family. Don't let us walk out of here the same. Help us to weep and mourn and fast and pray for 100 days if need be. Do something in our hearts and lives so we can make a difference in one more life before we exit out of this world. Please, Lord, fill us with your spirit. Fill us with your love. May the people, when they run against us or touch us or see us or feel, they will see the compassion of Jesus oozing out of every part of our lives. Too many church members and so-called Christians are negative, Debbie Downers, hurtful with their words and attitudes, raised on sour pickle juice. When God, you want to change us to be the most loving, compassionate, Christ-like people in our world. And I pray for our teachers out there, bus drivers and janitors. I pray for those in the nursing homes administering care to the last dying breaths of people. I pray for those in the hospital room. Give them compassion, we pray. Lord, what we need is a movement of compassion and love instead of division, instead of arguing, instead of fighting, instead of racism and thisism and thatism and all this stuff that divides. Lord, give us compassion. I'm praying too long. God, do something, we pray, among your people. But I can't pray for the people. It's the individuals who have to decide what they're going to do. Go back to your routine. Or are we going to go all in? Thank you, Lord, for those that you're calling right now. Thank you, Lord, for those that you're filling right now. Thank you, Lord, for those who are saying yes right now. The sin is gone. The laziness is gone. The indifference is gone. The fighting is gone. I take Jesus. I take Jesus and his love and compassion. Now, Lord, help us as we wrap up this service. We've got a busy day. Be with us, we pray. Keep doing your will. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship.
shall bow. In humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul,
to dismiss you guys.
I know not why God's wondrous grace to me hath made known, nor why unworthy Christ in love redeemed before his own. But I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I committed unto him against that day. Know not when my Lord may come at night or noonday fair, nor if I walk the veil with him or meet him in the air. But I know whom I have believed and am persuaded he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. And I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day.
God bless you guys. We'll see you next week.